Hey guys, how are you all doing? This is the MMA breakdown. My recap for UFC 166, Velazquez versus Dos Santos 3. People are going crazy about this card. I think the hype is a little unwarranted, just a bit. But overall, still a really good card. Let's just get into it. I'll give you my thoughts on all the fights and all the implications. Starting off with the Facebook prelim card, Kyoji Horiguchi defeated Dustin Pegg by TKO in the second round. I had picked Pegg to win this fight. He's really struggled to get a win in the UFC. I know he beat Jared Papazian, and I believe that's been his only win in the UFC. I think he's like 1-5 otherwise. 1-4, maybe. Let's see here. He's now 1-5 after losing to Horiguchi coming in. He was 1-4. The guy, he's got to, have the most submission attempts for a guy who's never had a submission. He did choke out Papazian, but I'm just saying this guy gets a lot of close submission attempts, but doesn't finish his opponent. Very similarly to John Albert, who was on the same season and was actually his first loss in the UFC. John Albert always locked up that triangle choke in his fights, but could never finish it. And Pegg seems to also be a pretty skilled grappler who always comes real close with either the triangle or some other choke, but can never finish his opponents. But Horiguchi really surprised me. I'm not big on the Japanese fighters just because a lot of them that are hyped up never seem to deliver on the hype. Kid Yamamoto and who's the other guy? Omegawa. But Horiguchi looked good in this fight. Pegg took the back early, looked like he might get the rear naked choke, had the back standing, but Horiguchi fought it off, and then he just leaped in and landed some vicious hooks. He's got an unusual striking style, but man, it was violent and it was effective. Just rocked Pegg, put him down, and finished him off. Good win for Horiguchi. Not sure what's next for him. Maybe Brian Caraway, test against a good grappler, but it was impressive. I really liked that performance by him. And Pegg, even though I'd like to see him stick around, I've enjoyed his fights. Finished emphatically in the first round, 1-5. There comes a point you've got to let a guy go. I kind of see why the UFC's kept him around. He's a skilled guy, usually puts on exciting fights, but 1-5, just let the guy go, let him get some wins, some success in another organization, and I'm sure he'll be back one day. Next fight at featherweight, but a catchweight because Feely missed weight by 3.5 pounds. Andre Touchy Feely defeated Jeremy Larson by TKO in round 2. I picked Feely going into this. I didn't know anything about him, never seen him fight. All I knew is he was from Alpha Male, and that's why I picked him. I think Alpha Male's got a real good camp, obviously, with the big guys, Faber, Benavidez, Mendez. But now they've started to add these young guys, and guys we're seeing on the Ultimate Fighter. TJ Dillashaw, Holdsworth, I think, is going to do well in the show. And now Feely, he looked great in this fight. Larson, another tough veteran. He was from Tough 15. Lost to Chiesa in the house, just out-wrestled. And then in the UFC, finished by Joe Proctor, also from that season. And then in his last fight against Martins, put on actually a really good brawl. Made that fight a lot more competitive than I thought it would be, but still ended up getting KO'd by Martins. And Larson, I just don't see the skill. I don't think he has much to offer, just pretty much a brawler. That's why I thought Feely would win. But anyway, Feely poured it on, hot right out of the gate, all over Larson. Both of them were exchanging. I think Larson got him down at the end of the first round. But great performance by Feely for a guy who had a tough weight cut. Said he was preparing for a fight at 170 just a few weeks earlier. Looked great in this fight. All over him. Real tenacious. Great hand speed. Hits hard. I'm excited to see this guy again. Good win for him. Can't blame him for missing weight, really. But who knows if he's going to stay at featherweight. Said he was getting ready for a fight at 170. Who knows what weight class he'll end up at. But looked really good, even against Larson. I thought it was a good fight. A good performance for Feely. Next up, lightweight fight. Tony Ferguson submitted Mike Rio in the first round by Darce choke. I picked Ferguson to win this fight. Mike Rio, a guy from Tough Live, Tough 15. Ferguson, the winner of Tough 13. Mike Rio, coming into the UFC, I thought he had a real hard-fought win in the finale when he beat John Kofor. Didn't do too well in the house, but he got an armbar over Kofor. I thought he looked pretty scrappy, tough. But then after that, lost to Francisco Trinaldo. But Tony Ferguson, this guy just came in red hot in the UFC. Took out Aaron Riley. Then had a real close fight with Yves Edwards, which I thought he lost. But real close, got the win. And then lost to Michael Johnson, which really derailed him. And then he was gone for like over a year. This was his first fight since then. And everyone kind of forgot about him. I thought Mike Rio, though, was really overmatched in this fight. And Ferguson's got great hands, great hand speed, real long arms. Throws punches at kind of weird angles. But Mike Rio shot him for the takedown after Ferguson was doing well on the feet. And Ferguson quickly locked up that Darce choke, jumped on it, and tapped Rio. Again, Rio, I think, was overmatched in this fight. But nonetheless, a good performance by Ferguson. Hopefully he gets a better guy. I don't think he's ready for top 10 or anything close to that. But, you know, I think there's some good fights out there for him. You know what? Miles Jury, I think that's a great fight. Miles Jury and Tony Ferguson. That's who I'd like to see him fight next. Up next, Adlan Amagov defeated TJ Waldberger by KO in the first round. I really hated to see Waldberger lose. The guy's not super popular in the UFC, but I've loved seeing this guy fight. He's a technician on the ground. I think it's always a treat to watch him fight. I love seeing great subs. And this guy's a submission monster. His armbar over Jake Hett, where, you know, he wasn't even touching the ground. And he made Heck tapped while... He made him tap while he was in the air yanking his arm. And then, you know, he's had some real good submission wins. A real tough fight with Ebersol where he nearly finished him. The guy's a submission wizard, and I love seeing him fight, and he had a good win streak going. I thought he'd win the fight, but Amagov, they tied up, and Amagov started to land some short shots from in the clinch, and one of them rocked Waldberger, and then you know, dropped to his knees and finished him off. And Waldberger was already out cold, and Amagov still landed a few punches. Ref didn't get there in time, but I still think that was rather disgusting. I think Amagov could have stopped earlier. And Waldberger, the interview with Amagov after the fight with Joe Rogan actually ended before they even showed if Waldberger could get up. Waldberger was actually still on the ground by the time all that had finished, so I was concerned for him, and pretty scary to see him down for that long, but he's okay. But I hope they don't cut him. I've loved watching him fight. The guy finishes fights, his submission wins. You know, he's been really good. I really hope they don't cut him. I'd be sad to see that. But Amagov showed big power for, you know, the shots he was throwing didn't look all that big, but he stopped Waldberger. Seems to have a lot of hype around him now. Not sure who I want to see him fight next, but good win for him and Waldberger. I'm afraid we've seen kind of his ceiling as a really skilled submission guy who doesn't have much to offer on the feet and also doesn't have that great a chin to become an elite fighter, but still really exciting. I think, you know, please don't cut this guy. I really enjoyed watching him. Next up, the Fox Sports 1 prelim card at lightweight. KJ Nunes defeated George Sotiropoulos by unanimous decision. I thought Sotiropoulos would win. I thought, you know, he's dropped a few fights, been knocked out twice. You know, I thought he'd be desperate, and I thought he would go right to work trying to get the takedown, get it to the ground. But he was content to stand and box with Nunes, and Sotiropoulos isn't a horrible boxer, but just kind of average, and I think I gave him one round in there, but I think I gave Nunes first and third. Nunes landed more shots, more effective with the boxing. It's just Sotiropoulos, like, what the fuck are you doing? He needed to get this to the ground. This guy's great on the ground. Like, what? Why not go for what you're good at, what you're great at? This guy submitted Joe Lozon. He's really good on the ground, and he was on a big win streak a few years back, and since has just been knocked out, and started with that loss to Seaver, and then he was knocked out twice in his last two fights. It's time for the guy to retire, and I'm really disappointed that, you know, he tried to box and, you know, never committed to getting the fight to the ground. I mean, the guy was really good. He submitted Joe Lozon. People probably forget that, but, you know, that's a huge achievement, and I feel like if he could have gotten this to the ground, he could have probably submitted Nunes. Anyway, next up, women's bantamweight fight. Jessica Eye defeated Sarah Kaufman by split decision. I picked Kaufman going into this. Kind of blindly picked her. I've only started following women's MMA since I came to the UFC. Never seen Kaufman or Jessica Eye fight. But Jessica Eye, she was using the jab. She was coming in and out more. Kaufman was landing, I think, the bigger shots, some more damaging shots. Pretty much just the right hand, going for those big kind of overhand rights. But close fight. I thought Kaufman won the... Actually, you know, I thought all the rounds were kind of close, and I think I gave Kaufman the first and the third, but it was close. I think she landed more shots, but Kaufman kind of landed fewer but bigger shots, and it was a good fight, pretty exciting. I gave it to Kaufman. I could see it going to I, but it was a close competitive fight. Women's division is still, you know, pretty thin, so I think, you know, both of them will have their opportunities again. Next up, welterweight Hector Lombard KO'd Nate Marquardt at the end of the first round. I picked Marquardt going into this, and I should have picked Lombard. The cut has not been working out for Marquardt. Somehow he ended up, he got that win over Tyron Woodley, but since then it's just been all downhill. Lost to Safadine, had his legs kicked to death. And then this just looked exactly like the Ellenberger fight. Just a smaller, more powerful, quicker guy. Totally getting inside and just destroying Marquardt. I think the guy's just too tall and too big for welterweight. And gets these little you know, hard chargers like Lombard and Ellenberger. These shorter guys who can close the distance on him real quick and just get to his chin. Which is, you know, glass at this point. But Marquardt, he was just kind of circling and staying in range with Lombard and never really committing or throwing anything big. And Lombard, just viciously knocked him out. Good win for Lombard. I think Marquardt's done, man. What else can he do at this point? The guy's got no chin left. But Lombard, everyone's saying, oh, the speed, the power. I'm not sold yet. Went over Marquardt. Marquardt coming off of two losses. He looked good, but it looked like the Paul Harris fight. Honestly, you know, a guy just stands in front of him and he blasts him. I don't see him doing that to, you know, the top guys like Condit, or I definitely don't think he could do that to GSP. Good win, but let's see, you know, who they give him next. I just had a thought in my mind of who he should fight next. Martin Campman. I think that would be a pretty good test for Lombard. Fighting an elite guy, Campman also, his chin is suspect. But I think that would be a good measuring stick for Lombard to see where he's at. I'd like to see him fight Campman. I think that makes a lot of sense. Moving on, middleweight Tim Boach defeated CB Dolloway by split decision. I picked Tim Boach going into this. He was on a real good run at middleweight, with his win over his finish of Yushin Okami, which was incredible, and then beat Lombard in a really boring fight. But dropped his last fight to, or his last two fights, actually. The last fight to Munoz got handled pretty thoroughly, and before that, lost to Philippou in a really an unfortunate fight for him where he was eye poked and headbutted. But anyway, I thought Boach was going to win this easily. Dolloway really surprised me. His hands looked really good. First round, I gave it to him. Totally outstruck Tim Boach. Second round, I can't remember too well, but I remember giving it to Dolloway. And then the third round, Boach got poked in the eye twice. Who can say whether it was intentional or not? But pretty unsportsmanlike. If you poke a guy in the once, I think you should just stop putting your fingers out, just out of caution. And not for yourself, but just, for your opponent out of respect. But Boach really turned it on. Really looked like he wanted to hurt Dolloway. I think he took him down, got on top. Was doing better on the feet in the third round. And I did give him the third round, although I thought it still could have gone to Dolloway. I thought it was close. But I was really surprised Boach got the decision. I thought Dolloway won the first two rounds. But anyway, I like Boach a lot more than Dolloway. I think Dolloway, is a little dirty after this fight. So hopefully Boach can, he had a good run. And I hope, I'd like to see him do well. But I have a feeling, he doesn't have too much left. And Dolloway showed a lot of improvement, and it was too bad that he had those eye pokes here, and I guess too bad the decision didn't go his way, but he showed some improvement here. On to the main card. Flyweight fight, John Dodson KO'd Daryl Montague in the first round. Daryl the Mongoose Montague, supposedly a high-ranked flyweight outside of the UFC. Never seen him fight before. John Dodson, though, I've been really big on this guy since he won the Ultimate Fighter. So explosive, his movement, he hops around, big power, unorthodox striking, but totally dominated Montague. He was all over him, knocked him down, and it looked like it was over. Montague showed great heart to recover and stay in there, got back up to his feet, but Dodson quickly nailed him just with a cross straight down the pipe, and real good win for Dodson. Real good performance coming off of his loss to Demetrius Johnson. Dodson will be a contender for a long time to come at flyweight. I think he could beat anybody in the division, maybe other than Johnson, but he's got time to improve, and he's going to be a real threat to anyone at flyweight. I don't think he'll get the title shot just yet. He'll probably have to fight one or two more guys, but I think he's number two or number three. I think a fight with Benavidez will also be really awesome. But I think, he's right there with Benavidez and Johnson. I think it could be both of them, or has the potential to be both of them. But it's going to be exciting to see how it'll play out for him. Next up, at heavyweight, Gabriel Gonzaga defeated Sean Jordan by KO in round one. I picked Sean Jordan actually going in this fight. You know, I was really impressed with him over, with his win over Pat Barry in his last fight. And Gabriel Gonzaga, while he has turned his career around a bit with a few good wins over... who was it? Dave Pee Wee Herman and Ben Rothwell. He's turning around a bit. I thought Jordan was just too young, too kind of on the rise and too much power for Gonzaga. But Gonzaga completely tooled him. Jordan came forward with a combination and Gonzaga countered him beautifully with a hook that it only took one shot and Jordan was put down. Put out and Gonzaga finished him. Really impressed with this one for Gonzaga. That's two wins in a row for him. 4-1, I believe, since coming back to the UFC after retiring. And I don't think he's gonna be a contender, but I think there's some really fun fights for him at heavyweight. You know, maybe the winner of Mark Hunt and Bigfoot. Stipe Miocic, I think that would be a good test for Miocic. I'd like to see him fight Miocic, but that's a good fight. He's done well to kind of turn his career around. And Sean Jordan derailed his hype train. He's still really green in the sport. I think he can get better, but his chin might have been exposed there. Next up, Gilbert Melendez defeated Diego Sanchez by unanimous decision. Great fight, incredibly entertaining. Diego Sanchez out of the gate took Gilbert's back immediately, and I thought, holy crap, he might actually choke out Melendez here. I picked Melendez going into this to win pretty thoroughly. Sanchez made it competitive in that third round, though, knocked him down. Came forward with a huge combination, but these guys were just back and forth. Great heart by both guys. I think Melendez pretty clearly outstruck him in the first and second. Every time Diego tried to get into a big exchange, Melendez landed more cleanly, and Sanchez got busted up real bad. Did get that knockdown in the third round. Just incredibly exciting, but I'm not a fan of this. I thought Sanchez, I was not high on him at all, especially after his last win against Gomi in a fight a lot of people thought he actually lost. I just thought he's looked flat for a long time. I mean, his last win was against Paulo Thiago, right? Like 3 years ago. Let me check here. Oh, no, okay, yeah, he beat Martin Kampman. Another fight everyone thought he lost. Lost to Ellenberger, and then his last fight against Gomi. But I just don't think the guy has, he's not competitive, really. I mean, again, Gomi and Kampman. First of all, Kampman was like 3 years ago, and Gomi, everyone thought he lost that fight. And he's had amazing wars, and this was entertaining, but I'm not really, I don't really want to see, a guy just getting beat up for the sake of entertainment. I would rather, if the guy can't be competitive and, we're at the point where we're not actually expecting him to win the fight, I don't really want to see him. I mean, for his own health, just, I'd like to see him retire. I really would. He's looked flat for a long time. Looked flat against Ellenberger, flat against Gomi. Kampman, and how many beatings does the guy have to take? BJ Penn, tore his face up. Kampman, nearly blinded him. And then Gilbert Melendez again. The guy's taking too much punishment and not competitive enough to warrant it. I like to see, very entertaining. I appreciate what he does, but for his own health, I'd like to see him retire. But good win for Melendez. Even though getting knocked down by Sanchez, I think doesn't look too good. He still got the win, still looked really good in his last fight against Henderson. I like to see him fight Nurmagomedov. I think that's the fight to make. And a winner of that, I think, should get a title shot. But, you know, good win for Gil, for El Nino. Now, the co-main event, I thought the main card, the pay-per-view, would have been perfect without this fight. Or if this fight, you know, I thought this fight was a stinker on the card. Daniel Cormier versus Roy Nelson. DC wins by unanimous decision. Won every single round. Nelson was not competitive at any point. But Cormier, I feel, you know, this guy's just kind of going through the motions. He knows he's more skilled than these guys. And he doesn't have that killer instinct. Coming to the UFC, I thought this guy was going to be a force. I was really looking forward to see him fight JDS when he came in to the UFC. But, you know, his fight against Mir, very uninspirational, very uneventful. And then this fight against Nelson, I don't know, he just looks like he's not really willing to impress. And I'm not seeing the same guy that beat Barnett. This doesn't look like the same Cormier to me. Still obviously very good. I think he could beat Dos Santos. I think he's the only guy at heavyweight who could beat Cain, but they won't fight. Says he's dropping down to 205. If he does, after his two fights in the UFC at heavyweight, I'm not excited about seeing him against Jones. I think he's got to make a statement, and he's got something to prove. But wasn't a big fan of this fight. Pretty boring when compared to all these other fights. And I don't know. I like to see Cormier, you know, look at least look like he wants to make a statement. But you know, was just kind of content to outpoint Nelson. And next at heavyweight, big fight. Cain Velazquez defeated JDS Junior Dos Santos by TKO in the fifth round. I almost said decision because I did not like the ending of this fight, but we'll get to that. Going into this fight, you know, I didn't know what to think. I mean, Velazquez won the last fight pretty dominantly, and JDS won the first fight. You know, everyone's saying that's a fluke, the first fight, but, you know, why is it a fluke? That's part of the game. If you knock a guy out in 5 seconds, you know, you knocked him out in 5 seconds, it doesn't mean that, you know, it didn't happen. I mean, that's what everyone trains to do, right? Is to go out there and just destroy people. So I thought both fights were perfectly valid. I kind of thought how Cain won the second time, you know, was kind of like how Junior won the first time. Cain, I thought, you know, him diving for takedowns in the middle of the cage and just kind of crawling around on the ground, grabbing for legs and getting back up. I didn't like that game plan too much in the first fight, or in the second fight. And then Cain nailed him with a big right hand in that second fight. And from there, Dos Santos never really recovered. And that and Cain was all over him. Anyway, though, this fight, I just said that to say that I don't really know what to think. I mean, I picked Cain. I thought it would, if I had to, you know, make a prediction, I thought it would look more like the second fight. But JDS in that second fight, he was hurt, but the whole time still dangerous, still throwing big shots. And in this fight, right out of the gate, tagged Cain, came forward, looked like Cain might have been in a little trouble, but Cain went right to work. His game plan, just to, you know, hold Dos Santos up against the fence, not give him any room to breathe, no room to strike to create power, and just work him over on the fence. I'm not saying it was boring. It wasn't boring one bit, but very smart game plan by Velazquez. And Dos Santos, again, showed so much heart. This guy can take such a beating and wasn't dropped until the fourth round, I think. And I thought Kane's wrestling was actually better in this fight than in the second fight. I don't know the stats, but it seemed like to me he got more takedowns. But Kane's a good striker, and he's a good wrestler, and he's a good clinch fighter. Just put it on Dos Santos. Every now and then, Dos Santos would fire back a few shots, throw some elbows with his back to the cage. Got a little scared, thought Kane might go down, but showed great heart. I just wish Velazquez, he knocked him down in the fourth round. I got excited. I thought I might be stopped there. I really wanted Velazquez to finish this fight to really definitively, you know, assert himself as the best heavyweight, which he still did. I'm just saying the finish in the fifth round, Dos Santos, all beat up and bloodied, somehow managed to lock up, like, I guess, a power guillotine, kind of like a ninja choke. And, again, looked like Dos Santos might be able to finish the fight with that. And Kane, I don't know whether Dos Santos hit his head because of the way Kane rolled and tried to escape, or because JDS just fell on his head and, you know, he was really kind of half-conscious but of what he was doing. But he had the choke. Kane fell on his back. Dos Santos hit his head on the floor and couldn't get back up. And the fight was stopped that way. Kane was clearly on his way to winning that fight unless something miraculous happened, but I just didn't like the finish. I know that's you know, like, I shouldn't be complaining about it. It was such a, you know, great performance by Kane, but I just want to see Kane finish with strikes. But Kane, you know, he's number one, two fights in a row that looked exactly the same, just put a beating on Dos Santos, and I think clearly put himself ahead of Dos Santos and put, you know, this trilogy behind him. Dos Santos again showed great heart, but he's number two for now. And he could clearly, I mean, he could easily beat every other heavyweight there is. Dos Santos could, he could just knock him out. But I think it's back to the end of the line for him. You know, he's had two chances now, and you know, I don't think he deserves another fight. I think he's got to go through a whole bunch of guys. And, you know, I think you got to let the division move and let Kane fight these other guys. And Dos Santos is going to have to work his way back up again. But it's such a interesting position because, you know, Dos Santos can't fight like the number one guy because he'll knock him all off, and if you knock off all the number one guys, you have to get the shot again. But you know, I don't think him and Velazquez should fight for a long while, meaning like at least 2 or 3 years. But you know, let Velazquez fight these other guys, and Dos Santos, if he won't, you know, who knows what he wants to do, but if he stays in the sport, you know, he's gonna have to, you know, he's going to have to wait his turn, and he's probably going to look real impressive and just blow through all these other guys again. But, you know, Kane's got other people to fight, and he's clearly shown he's been better than Dos Santos 2 out of 3 times. But Kane, you know, Dos Santos is far ahead of the rest of the heavyweight division, and Kane is ahead of him. So I really feel, you know, Kane, he's gotten through the toughest guy twice now, the most dangerous guy, the guy who's going to, you know, have the best chance of beating him. And I think Kane is home free now. It's going to be all downhill from here. You know, that might mess with your head a little bit once, you know, everything starts going easy for you and you're fighting a whole bunch of guys that are outmatched against you. But, you know, I think Kane's going to go on a long run here, you know. Verdum is next, I guess. And people are saying the UFC is trying to build that up as a competitive fight. I mean, that's their job, but that's not competitive at all. I mean, I'd be totally shocked if, you know, that fight was even remotely competitive. Verdum's not going to submit Kane, and Kane's going to knock him out, either on the ground or on the feet. But You know, I think Kane can beat a bunch of guys. The winner of Brown and Barnett, I think, should fight one day for the title. The only guy that I think could seriously compete with Kane is DC, but of course they're not going to fight. So I really see Kane going on a long run here, being a whole bunch of guys. Maybe fight with Dos Santos down the road one day, but I think Kane's going to be the champion unless Jones can come up from light heavyweight and challenge him. I think it's going to be kind of easy going for him. He's going to be able to coast now. But that's my recap for UFC 166, Velazquez versus Dos Santos 3. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. Really appreciate it. I'd appreciate it if you'd give the video a like. Please subscribe. And definitely comment if you want to challenge me on anything I said or just your thoughts on any of these fights. All right, guys, check out my recap for UFC Fight Night 30, Machida versus Munoz, or 31, I guess. But take care. I'll see you guys later. Bye.